your gates with thanksgiving, and with thanksgiving we enter your gates. We pour out your praise in your presence, and in your presence we pour out your praise. And the song we sing forevermore. Oh, glory to the Father. Oh, glory to the Son.
Your praise, we're here to love you, we're here to seek your face. Oh God, let your light fill this place. We're here to worship, we're here to bless your name, we're here to honor our Lord and gracious King. Oh God, be enthroned in our praise. Our cries, oh come and shower down your love, come and meet us with your touch. We yield our hearts, give you our thoughts, we're here for only you, oh God. We're here to worship, we're here to sing your praise, we're here to love you, seek your face, oh God, let your light fill this place. We're here to worship, we're here to bless your name, we're here to honor our Lord and gracious King, oh God, be enthroned in our praise. Oh God, hear our cry. Our thoughts, we're here for only you, oh God. So come and shower down your love, come and meet us with your touch. We heal our hearts, give you our thoughts, we're here for only you, oh God. We're here to worship, we're here to sing your praise, love you, we're here to seek your face, oh God, let your light fill this place. Oh God, let your light fill this
Lord of all. You're the Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. To the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. To the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. To the Lord.
Genesis, what does it mean again? Origins, absolutely. Have you found out new things as we go through the book? New things from an old book? How many times have you read it? A lot of times. It's good stuff though, isn't it? You know, over and over and over we read about the origin of everything. Us and our story, the beginning of the world, the beginning of sin in the world, and I think the more we read it and look at it, whether it's Genesis or anywhere else through Scripture, we find more and more why the world is the way it is. When people see and question what's going on in the world, we realize it's nothing new. It's been happening ever since the beginning. Why do people struggle against one another? It's not always because we're struggling against each other, but we struggle against God and His will. So, very good verses you brought up today, Deb, in terms of referencing that part of things. We're looking today in a portion of Genesis. We're going to jump through and skip over a bunch. We could spend probably another year and a half going through this book as we did through Luke and other books, but I'm kind of charging through with a glimpse through Genesis with the hope and the desire that you will go back and read through in detail and study a little bit of the in-betweens and really dive into it. It's good stuff, and it's good to be reminded of it. But today we're going to be looking at this idea of being tested by God and what Abraham went through in his struggle with God and his promise from God, from his son and about his son, Isaac. Was Isaac his firstborn? No. Firstborn was? Ishmael. We're going to take a look at why we look at some verses today and read them and think, what does that mean? Why is that there? Always good not to question the word, but to question why God puts the word together the way he does. It's all one big story. I always talk about context. Context is very important when we read Scripture. Why is that particular saying or phrase or teaching where it is? And how does it refer to not just itself within the book and the other writings of that particular time, but how does it relate to all of Scripture? When you talk about context in Scripture, it's the whole thing. Everything is connected. And we'll see that very clearly when we look at some parts of what we look at today in Genesis 22, in testing. First, we've got to clarify, though, testing versus temptation. We need to know the difference between the two. Testing is something that comes from God. God tests us. He tests our faith. He tests our ability to trust Him. He tests us in terms of, do we really believe what He says? Do we really believe what we say we profess to believe? Do we really, really, completely and entirely love Him, love our neighbor, and do the things He's commanded? A test always is there to build up our faith. A test is there to strengthen us, to encourage us, really, in the end. Like when you go through school, whether it's elementary school or getting into college, university, and throughout life, when we're tested, we are always trying to find out what we know, right? The instructor, whether it's the kindergarten teacher or the English professor, is trying to test what we know. So God tests us in what we know about Him, His character, and who He is. And we see the result of that. Maybe I know it. Or maybe I need to know a little more. That's what the results of the test will show us. A temptation is different. A temptation is something that wants to draw us down. A temptation is something that wants to have us look at something that's maybe flawed in our character and build on it. A temptation leads us towards walking away from God rather than drawing us to Him. Temptations are not from God. God doesn't tempt us. He allows us to be tempted. And he will never, according to his word, allow us to be tempted beyond anything we're able to bear. He will always provide a way of escape. We can always get away from temptation. And usually the best way is to use that little powerful two-letter word. No, I'm not going there. I'm not going to let that have power over me. A temptation is much different than a test. Remember that as we go through Genesis 22, which is where we're going to dive into today. So if you got your Bible, or I do have it on the overhead, we're going to look at about 19 verses from Genesis today, and the sacrifice and the testing that Abram had to face. After these things, well, we got to stop there. What things? Flash review, where were we at last week? We were talking about Abraham and the initial promise that God gave him about building nations through him. And then things happened. He's old. He's in his 90s now. And Sarah is in her 80s. And God's saying, oh, I'm going to give you a child. And they're like, ha! Literally, they laugh, both of them. But God does give them a child. But not before Abraham and Sarah get a little idea between them that they should maybe do things on their own. Because, hey, God, let's go here. You know, time is marching on, and we can't do this on our own. So here, take my Egyptian slave girl. And Abraham, you have her for a wife. And they have a child. And that's Ishmael, his firstborn. And when Hagar, the slave, has this child, she looks back on Sarah with contempt. And look what I did. I took your husband and I had a child by him and gave him his first seed. And she hated Hagar for this and treated her poorly and eventually sent her off, her and Ishmael. They sent them both away. As time went by, Abraham said, you do with her as you please. And so they sent her away into the desert, basically to die. But God saw her there. And he remembered that he had said, I will also bless Ishmael and make a great nation out of him. Not great necessarily as following him, but a great nation, a great big nation. A lot of people have come from Ishmael. Many people believe that is where much of the Arab nation today has come from, and many of the nations who are against Israel have come from was through Ishmael. They're a great big nation. And God did bless them, and they do very well, don't they? God keeps his promises. Also, these things include the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, a city that was many describe as the most sinful city that has ever existed in the history of the world, one that had totally gone apart from God and away from his ways, that got lost in the sin, their main sin of homosexuality, to the point where when God came to visit and see if it really was as bad as it seemed to be, that, you know, the whole town came out, every man from the old to the young, and wanted to have sex with the three angels that came to town. Twisted. The only ones that God spared was Lot and his family, Abraham's nephew. Took them out, saved them, and said, don't look back, just get away from there. But Lot's wife did turn back, had a look, and she became a salt shaker. We call a pillar of salt in Scripture. But God said, no, don't even look back. So the quick lesson is, don't ever look back on sin. Just turn away. Turn away. And now Ishmael and Hagar are off in the desert. God has spared them. And now he has but one son, because they did have a child, Isaac. In their 90s, Abraham was 99 years old. That's getting pretty up there to be a father, for Sarah to be a mother, and to raise this child now. Can you imagine? But can you imagine how much they loved the child that God gave them, even in their old age? How precious he must have been, because he was the promise. He was the one that they said, I'm going to build a nation through you. If you can number your children, it'll be like the stars. It'll be like the sand of the sea. That's a lot of kids. Not necessarily all hers, but the nation, which would eventually become Israel, and the promise, which would eventually become Christ. I love Scripture and the way it flows together. All that from the first three words. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, I wonder what God's voice sounded like. And he said, here I am. God said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Wow. Really? Go murder my son. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of God, the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son, who was now a late teenager, by the way. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went, both of them together. And he said to his, and Isaac said to his father, "Dad, my father, Abba." And Abraham said, "Here I am, my son." And Isaac said, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham said, I'm pretty sure with tears in his eyes, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." See, he knew what he was going to do, what needed to be done. But he had to tell his son, "God will provide." Isaac believed him. So they went, both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there, laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand, took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham, whoa, 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 whoa." And he said, "Here I am." "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its thorns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time and said, By myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you've done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you. And I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore." Now he's going crazy with numbers. It's the stars and the sand. The blessing has increased. It's just hyperbole. But at the same time, he's telling Abraham, this is a great blessing. "Your offspring shall possess the gates of his enemies, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you've obeyed my voice." So Abraham returned to his young men. They arose and went together to Beersheba, and Abraham lived at Beersheba. We'll pause there for this week. Here I am, and here we are. I shake a little bit when I read that. Trying to imagine and put yourself in Abraham's place, hearing the voice of God calling out your name. "Hey, Steve. Hey, Terry. Hey, Catherine, Sue, all of you." Do we hear his voice? Abraham cried out right away, "Here I am." Unlike Adam, who when he heard the voice of God went and hid. Abraham, now in his 90s, realizes, you know what? There's no getting away from God. Here I am. What now? Everything he's gone through in his life, and here God's calling him again. What now? Here I am. "Take your son, your only son." Was it his only son? Physically, no. Ishmael was still alive and well, though Abraham maybe did not know that at this point. But this was the only son that he loved. This was the only son that he was promised. This was the result of God's promise that through you and through Sarah, you will have a child. This is Isaac. This is the son you love. Go to a place that I will show you. Sound familiar? He'd heard this back when he was about 65, 70 years old, when God said, leave your house, leave your people, leave everything behind and go to a land I will show you. Again, here's Abraham not knowing where he's going. He's just heading to this area over here, Moriah, down in the south, down in the wilderness, down in the desert, up above the Dead Sea. Lovely place. See, he's been living up in the north where it's green and beautiful by the Sea of Galilee. It's gorgeous. I've seen these places and it's wonderful up there. Now you want me to walk for 3 days and go to Moriah? There's nothing there. It's empty wilderness. And it is. When you talk about nothing, it's nothing. It's just bare rock, dry, arid, bleh. No place you want to go camping, walking, or doing nothing, but that's where God said to go. Which mountain? I'll show you. You'll know when you get there. Are we there yet? I'll let you know. Are we there yet? I'll let you know. Right? And now at 100 years old, God, do you want me to go on a 3-day walking journey in the wilderness? He didn't have a conveyance of some kind to get him there. He had to walk for 3 days through the wilderness. And I'm guessing it was hot and dry and miserable. I like to stay in the air conditioning or sit in a cool pool or by a nice, wonderful lake. But no, 3 days walking through the wilderness. 3 days through nothing. 3 days away from everything that's familiar. Those must have been bad days. Especially knowing at the end of those days, at the end of the journey, God had told him to sacrifice his son. I don't know how well you do with bad news and holding it in. But Abraham didn't tell Isaac this was happening. Isaac may have bolted. Oh, Dad's going to kill me. I'm out of here. He doesn't tell Sarah. He just says, hey, we're going for a trip. I'm taking a couple of the guys with me. I'm going to take our boy, and we're going to go for a walk. We're going on a walkabout. No, we get nothing. He knows, and he alone knows what God has asked of him. Can we imagine being in Abraham's place, taking something that's so precious, a child, our only child, and God's saying, don't just offer him to me and set him aside for me as Samuel had been done by his mother, and you'll set aside to serve the Lord, or set aside like Samson to live a life that was dedicated to God, or set aside as Jesus' disciples did. They left everything to follow him. No, take your son and sacrifice him to me. And that doesn't mean just kill him. No, it means slit his throat, split him down the middle, and put him on the altar. That's what I want you to do to your son. I can't imagine. And yet here, Abraham obeys without question. Early in the morning, up they go. He could have said, and maybe in our human thinking, we would say it'd be easier to say, well, what about Ishmael? Why don't I get that son? That's my firstborn. I'll go get him and I'll sacrifice him. Or how about one of my servants? How about anyone else but Isaac? God, how about me? Take me instead. You want a sacrifice? Take me. He's the promised one. He's the seed. You had all these promises and things you were going to do through him. So take him. Use him. Live in and through him. Take my life instead. The only thing I can relate to that, to even get close to that, is when our son was diagnosed with cancer. Had surgery. And we get the news that this is a 70% chance he's not going to make it. That's the stats on this particular cancer. I sat up all night in that room, separated from my son in a bit of a clean area. He was in one room, I'm in the next one. He's sleeping, and I'm praying and struggling with God through the night, pleading, wrestling, fighting, arguing with God, saying, why him? Why my boy? Take me instead. Spare his life. Take mine. And tears and just confusion and prayer and worship and that all night long. And that's the closest I can even get to think of what Abraham must have been thinking, that God told Abraham to sacrifice his son himself. Not that something would happen to him, but that he would have to do it himself. Pick up that knife and thrust it through his son's neck and then split him up the middle. Put him on the altar and light it on fire and burn his flesh. I don't know. I don't know how Abraham could obey that. God, what are you asking me to do? This? And yet without question, Abraham obeyed and went. Now we know the end of the story, that it didn't actually happen. This was a test. Man, was it a test. And the test in my prayers for our boy was, in the end, not my will, yours be done. I didn't understand why God would allow our son to go through cancer and possibly face death and everything else that was going to be nasty about dealing with cancer. I did not know why. Abraham didn't know why God would ask him to sacrifice his son, but he trusted him, as we had to trust God for our boy, as you may have had to trust God in the hardest of times you faced. And in questioning, why, God, why would you allow this? What's going on? Why do we have to suffer like this? Just trust. God knows the end story. We might lack understanding, but it doesn't mean we should doubt the Lord. Abraham had learned that throughout his life. God's plans, God's ways are so much higher than our ways. He sees the whole picture. He knows the beginning and the end. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He knows the future. He knows the past. He knows my past. Things I did yesterday, things I did a long time ago. Things I'm going to do. And yet he still chooses to love me. Do we look at life and do we look at God the same way? It is our place to trust and obey, not to question and lose our faith. It is ours to trust and obey, not question and lose faith. So they go 3 days up to Moriah. Moriah is now where Jerusalem is built and stands. Mount Moriah, the very rock at the center and the base of the temple, is where Solomon built the great place of worship to the Lord. Standing today is the Dome on the Rock Mosque, right over the rock. In fact, the rock that is there is held by those who follow the religion of Islam, the place where the prophet rose to heaven. But it is also the place where we understand that that's where Abraham offered Isaac, his son, to the Lord. Wait here while we go ahead. So Jesus said with his disciples in Gethsemane, he took just a couple of his disciples with him to go and pray in the very deepest, darkest place of his life as he faced taking on the sin of the world. See the reflective picture between Abraham and Christ here? We're just going to go here and we'll go on ahead and we'll be back. Almost the same words in the Gospels as Jesus went to pray and talk with his Father, because Jesus is our sacrificial lamb. He took our place as God provided the ram for Isaac's place. It's a beautiful picture. A beautiful simile. Isaac had questions. Think about Isaac for a moment. Young man, he's gone through all the the rites of passage of a growing teenager. He's almost a man, and he's saying, okay, Dad, we've done this before. We've built sacrifices and altars, and we've worshiped God together. We've called on the name of the Lord together. Beautiful picture. We got wood. We got fire. But where's the lamb? Abraham knew and answered appropriately. God will provide a lamb. God will provide a sacrifice. I think his words actually probably reflect more of the Lamb of God that would take away the sin of the world. I think maybe in some moment of vision, he knew that God was going to provide a way to get out of this. I bet you he hoped with all his heart he would. But even if he didn't, Abraham wasn't going to lose faith again. He doubted before. He laughed at God when he said, oh, I'm going to give you a son in your old age. He learned not to laugh. He learned to trust. And so they proceeded to the place. They made the altar. That means getting big stones and building a rock base. They prepared the wood that they'd carried for 3 days. And now Isaac has hauled up on his back up the mountain to the top of Moriah. And they're at this place. They've set up the stones. And now they start placing the wood on it just so. And Abraham pulls out the rope. The rope that would have been used to tie up the lamb, to tie its legs, to mute its mouth as they go through the process of slitting its throat and cutting it in pieces. I don't know if he had to wrestle Isaac, if he had to hold him down. I don't know what that moment looked like because we're not told. But I imagine those must have been the hardest moments of his life. God, really? Okay. You're asking me to do this? I don't know why. But I'm trusting you. And he ties up his son and lays him on the altar, and he raises that knife. I don't know that I could. You're asking me to murder? God, that's against everything that morally you would say is okay. How could I do this? Kill my own son? He didn't question. He just obeyed. That's hard. But in that moment when he was about to slit his son's throat, God said, whoa, Abraham! Abraham! Stop. Now I know. Now I know that you fear God. Did God need to know that? Of course not. God already knew. God knows everything. He knew exactly what was going to happen. He knew he wasn't going to go through with allowing Abraham to kill his son. Who needed to know? Abraham needed to know. Isaac needed to know. They needed to know that they would trust God in any circumstance. That nothing can be withheld from God if he asks for it. That everything belongs to him, that he is the ultimate authority in this universe, that it's not my way or the highway, it's God's way and no other way. They needed to know that God is all-powerful, all-knowing, and needs to be listened to and obeyed and trusted. What do we need to know today? How do we need to be reminded that this is who we've come to worship here today? In song and in prayer, in the Word? What do we need to know today? Do we need to know that God is truly still in control, that no matter what's happening in the world, he is still trustworthy, he is still faithful, he's still good, and he still has provided a lamb for anyone who would believe, and that is Christ. Do we need to know that God has provided a lamb? He provided his only son. And when the time came for the nails to be driven into Jesus' hands, for the spear to be thrust through his side, for him to be sacrificed, God did not stop it. Abraham got to the point of bringing the knife down. God didn't let it end for his son. He didn't put a stop to Jesus' death. He went all the way. God needs us to know that he is willing to do anything to save us, even sacrifice his own son that he loves. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That word, that verse got a little deeper meaning. God didn't hold back. He could have. Imagine the Father's heart as he's looking down at his only son being beaten and berated by the humans that he created. And watching this all play out, and watching that soldier hold that spike on Jesus' hands and get ready to pound the nails through, he could have said, "Stop!" He didn't. One hand, two hands, 2 feet. One nail for the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All of God, all of his love, poured out on the cross, nailed to it, and put up for all the world to ridicule an act of love, of absolute sacrifice. This is our God. Do we need to know the extent of his love and what he's willing to go through so that you and I, in our weakness and our frailty, can be saved from the destruction that we all deserve? That's God's love poured out on the cross for you and I, and for anyone who would say yes. The result of Abraham's obedience was a confirmation of the blessing that God had already given him twice. And now he doubles up on it. Once he says, your children will be like the stars. Once he says, they'll be like the sand. Now he says, it's going to be like the sand and the stars. I'm going to make such a blessing out of you, and the whole world is going to be blessed through you. How? Through Christ. Because through Isaac's seed, we can follow all the way to Christ. We can follow all the way to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God wants us, requires us, to be obedient when he speaks. Why? Because he is absolutely trustworthy. Something I read in 1 Samuel this week is that verse that reminds us that it is better to obey than to sacrifice. 1 Samuel 15. God rejected Saul as king because he didn't obey. Are we obedient to what God has told us to do? When he's called your name and said, hey, I need you. I'm asking you, I'm telling you, I'm commanding you to go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the very end of the age. Are we obedient? or are we doing things our way? Do we worship God in celebration of His faithfulness? Can you imagine the relief and the joy and the worship when God said, just take that knife and yeah, toss that. You don't need that anymore. I bet you only used it for one thing. And that's cutting the cords that were holding Isaac down on the altar. And I bet you he never touched that knife again. We've been set free. We deserve to be on the altar. We deserve to be punished for the sins in our life. But God made a way. He provided a ram for Abraham. And He's provided the lamb for us. And maybe we need to know that no matter what tests we face in life, we can trust God. No matter what things come to maybe even tempt us, we have to trust God. He says, I've given you authority in this world over all these things. We get to tell Satan to go shove off. Him and all his temptations. We get to look at God when He tests us and say, thank you, God, for reminding me that I can trust you. That I know the answer, and it's you. Do we worship God in celebration of His faithfulness? Because that's what this story is all about. It's not really about Abraham and Isaac. It's all about God and His faithfulness to us. That God keeps His promises. God said, through your seed, I will build all these nations. Well, I think Abraham probably needed to know that so that he could trust God that it's going to happen. Even if he did kill his son, he would have believed that he's going to raise him up again. God's able to do that. Is anything too hard for God? Nothing. We are subject to God always, and His will is supreme. So much so. Amen. We're so loved and blessed by God that He would provide a way for us to be with Him forever through His Son. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Oh, the rejoicing. Whether it's John seeing Jesus walk up to be baptized, or the disciples who saw Jesus risen from the dead, walking and talking again, or anyone who says, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I thank you for paying the price for my sin. I believe. Forgive me. And help me to live my life for you from this day onward. I want to get to know what it is to follow you. I want to know what it means to share the kind of love you've demonstrated. I want to know you're the best. I know there's no other way. That's the best. Seeing someone set free, having their cords cut, seeing them taken off the altar and walking in life with Christ. There's nothing better in this world. And we're going to celebrate that forever with Christ. One day when we see Him face to face. Amen? Let's pray. God, thank you. Thank you that we can gather here together and open your word freely and learn what you have taught us through the ages. That you are trustworthy. That you are the Lord who does not change. The plan is not going to change. The way of salvation is never going to change. There's no other way. It is just through Christ. He's the way, the truth, and the life, and the only way back to you. Thank you for demonstrating to us your love and your willingness to do whatever it took to get us back in a right relationship with you. May we never forget that, God. May we celebrate that here and in life out in the world so that others might see that living with you and for you is the best and it's the only way. It's the way we were designed to be, is in a right relationship with our Creator. That's never going to change. And so, God, we bless you today and we thank you for the gift of your word. And as we are able to be part of the family of God because of Abraham's faithfulness, because of what Christ has done, We are indeed, as we've talked about today, grafted into the family of God. We are your children, all who believe. And so, God, I pray that we do today, that we believe that your word is true and it's trustworthy as you are. May we read it, love it, learn it, and share it with others as we go about this world and in this life proclaiming the gospel of Jesus until we take our last breath this side of heaven or until we lift our eyes up and see him coming on the clouds of heaven. Lord, we bless you and we love you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen.
And Lord, we thank you and that you are the King of Kings. And we pray that this week, as we go out, we will, in our personal lives and our corporate lives, crown you Lord of all. Thank you for what we have learned today. Help us to ruminate over it and just bring it up during the week for us. Remind us of how we can be faithful as Abraham was faithful. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith and take hold of the eternal life to which you are called. I, Paul, charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see, to him be the honor and might forever. Amen. See, Paul squirrels. I love that. Squirrel. We were talking about God, and he's unapproachable and immortal, invisible. That was from 1 Timothy 6. Thank you. You are dismissed.